Greetings and welcome to Breast Cancer and Nutrition, Creating a Healthy and Happy Relationship with Food. At this time, all participants are in a listen-only mode. You can send your questions in by typing them in the Ask a Question field on the left side of your screen. If anyone should require technical support, simply click the question mark icon on the upper right corner of your webcast player screen. As a reminder, this conference is being recorded. I would now like to turn the conference over to your host, Emily Biever, Senior Dietitian at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. Thank you. You may begin.
I'm really pleased and excited to be here with everyone today. My understanding is while we have some people in the room live, we also have a lot of people from all over the place joining us. So welcome to everybody here, and welcome to everybody that is listening in. I am a senior clinical dietitian here at Dana-Farber, and I'm really excited for the fact that I was asked to present on breast cancer, but also incorporate what healthy eating and what having a healthy relationship with eating looks like as you go through this journey. So I'm really excited because I'm able to pull together a presentation that I gave for breast cancer and then pull together a presentation that I used while I was presenting in Dubai on integral nutrition. So this is a wonderful way that to sew these two concepts and these two presentations together. So I'm so glad I have the opportunity to actually fuse these two of my passions together in this presentation. So without further ado, this is essentially what an integral look at breast cancer and nutrition would look like. So what does an integral perspective mean? Ken Wilber is an integral theorist. He's an American philosopher, and he came up with this integral perspective on pretty much any phenomenon. So if we're looking at law, if we're looking at agriculture, if we're looking at education, you can apply an integral look or an integral perspective to almost any phenomenon. So I decided, because I was so into this whole integral, integrative perspective, that I wanted to apply it to nutrition, more specifically oncology nutrition. So an integral perspective essentially means something that's really holistic, comprehensive. We're not just isolating the things that we can measure, but we're also taking a look at the things we can't measure, or you might refer to them as the intangibles. So we have tangible pieces of any phenomenon. In this case, in terms of nutrition, we're really familiar with the things we can measure, supplements, herbs, how much fat, how much protein, fruits, vegetables, and what are the phytochemicals in them, body composition and activity levels. So when we look at somebody's nutrition, this is very typically where we start, and unfortunately a lot of times where we end looking at our patient's nutrition. So the cool thing about an integral perspective is that it also includes looking at food systems, the healthcare system, the other things we can measure from more of a system perspective. And then we also look at the intangibles, things we can't actually measure. What are people's relationships with food? We all have our own personal relationship with food. What about the family culture or the food culture that we live in, cultural beliefs related to food and disease, food and cancer in this instance. So we're going to be taking a very comprehensive, integral look at breast cancer and nutrition over the next hour. But we're going to start with those measurable things because those are important. Just because that's where we oftentimes start and stop doesn't mean they're not as important. They're very important. And so before we even talk about nutrition, particularly with breast cancer, we have a lot of evidence that we need to consider physical activity levels. How much are you moving? I oftentimes will tell people, just as with nutrition, it's really important with physical activity that you find the stuff that you love, and that's what you focus on. So my coworker, Nancy Campbell, who's our exercise physiologist here, will oftentimes say, if you told me that I had to do Zumba 30 minutes a day for the rest of my life for physical activity, I'd go nuts, because she is a little bit maybe dance challenged. I don't know if that's a phrase, but I'm going to use it. But you have to find the physical activity that you enjoy doing and make it a regular part of your lifestyle, because we have evidence that this helps reduce risk for recurrence. So not only cardio activity, you'll see here 30 minutes, 5 days a week of brisk walking is what the data shows, that in and of itself, and that's not very much, 30 minutes a day for 5 days a week. It might be other kinds of cardio, but I also want to emphasize the importance of doing some type of strength-based exercise as well. So weight-bearing activity, whether it's using free weights or machines or bands, the recommendations for general population are to be including strength-based exercise 2 to 3 times a week. So that also applies for our young women that are going through cancer treatment. We want to protect your lean muscle mass because that alone has also been linked to reduce risk of recurrence. Okay, so strength-based exercise, cardio exercise, find the ways that you want to manifest those and do them on a regular basis. Find the stuff you love and go do it. All right, nutrition, though. You came here or you're tuned in because you wanted to listen to nutrition, so let's jump into that. With oncology and with a cancer diagnosis, there comes quite a bit of overwhelm for most people when they're trying to figure out what in the world they're supposed to eat. If you look on the World Wide Web, you are going to become confused, overwhelmed. There's a lot of stuff that's conflicting. Here is just, I mean, I think in 5 or 10 minutes, this is what I found on the internet, okay? So a lot of different recommendations, a lot of different diets. Most of them are kind of conflicting. If you do a deep dive, they contradict one another. And I just have to, I had to include this little blurb at the end of the, one of the websites. It might be hard to read, but it says, all decisions are the responsibility of the reader and common sense of it all shall apply. Well, thanks a lot. So you're telling me I should do a diet maybe where I just eat grapes all day long, but I should use my common sense when doing so. Okay. So what are our recommendations? My hope is that you leave this time tuning in or being here today feeling comfortable and a sense of confidence and ease in how you're going to eat to nourish yourself from now forward. So these are our recommendations, and what I share today also, it's important for you to take what feels and resonates with you. Because also that's going to be important that you enjoy what you're eating. So from what I discuss and recommend, you choose what resonates with you, and that's going to be the most successful way to move forward with this information today. So what are our recommendations here at Dana-Farber? Okay, Michael Pollan has this book, Food Rules, an Eater's Manual, and his line, which is, I think is even on the front of the book, is something we very much advocate here at Dana-Farber. So eating food, I would argue that this is not food. Why would I say that? Because I would have a very difficult time defining what is in this bowl. As I would imagine most of us in this room or online would have an issue defining. I mean, maybe you'd be good at saying, you know, red 40 or lake 30 blue or something like that. But this, I would say, is an engineered food product. I can't really tell you what I'm eating. I can, however, tell you, oops, that was supposed to come up a little bit differently, but I should be able to tell you here what I'm having to eat at this meal. So this is oats, honey, and berries. So one, if we only make one change with how we're nourishing ourselves moving forward, that would have a really big impact. Finding foods that you are able to identify and doing that most of the time would make a huge impact in terms of your nutrition. So be able to identify most of your food over the course of the day. When we think about convenience foods, bars, protein bars, shakes that you buy at a store, you would probably struggle to tell me what is in that food. So instead of maybe a protein bar, you might be able to do an apple and some peanut butter. You can tell me exactly at that snack what you're having to eat. Okay? Eat mostly plants. Oh, shoot. Sorry. This is not coming up. So I'm not entirely sure why that's happening. But you would be able to use your imagination, everybody. You would be able to see a basket of produce. And that basket of produce is essentially to remind you that we want to eat a mostly plant-based diet. All of the data that exists, we look at Mediterranean diets, we look at diets that have a lot of whole grains, colorful veg and fruit. this data and looking at populations of people that eat mostly plant-based foods tend to have reduced risk for lots of disease, including cancer. And then, not too much, and if you could see this slide, if you could see this visual pop-up, this visual is showing people's hands. So I like to tell people that at all times you have a measuring device on you for roughly the appropriate portion sizes for you at mealtimes. So portion size-wise, if we make a fist and you look at your fist, this is roughly the portion size of starchy or carbohydrate-rich foods at a meal. If you make a fist with both hands, and you put them next to each other, this is roughly the portion size of these colorful phytonutrient-rich veg and fruit. And we'll talk more about those in a second. So lots of veg at a mealtime, watching our portion size of starch at mealtimes, and the palm of our hand is typically the portion size of protein at mealtimes. Again, just have that loosely, hold on to that loosely, because we'll actually see that play out here in a few slides. Okay, so why a plant-based diet? Why do we have to have a lot of color over the course of the day? The reason why is because the color of a plant, whether it's a vegetable or a fruit, is the way the plant expresses its immune system. So by consuming a variety of different colors over the course of the day, you're consuming a variety of different phytochemicals or plant immune systems. So this chart gives you just a brief look at some of the phytochemicals that are found in veg and fruit and whole grains as well. I actually just recently learned this within the past year or so, that whole grains also have these phytochemical anti-cancer, anti-disease properties in them, even though they're brown. So even some of the brown whole grains actually possess these phytochemicals as well. So that chart, you can see that chart, there's a lot of stuff. There's also a lot of phytochemicals that scientists are aware they have not even discovered yet. So these phytochemicals, or we can also refer to bioactive components in foods and herbs and spices, you might have heard of some of these, turmeric or curcumin, green tea. We have shown, the evidence is there, that these have anti-tumor, antioxidant properties. Caution has to be made, though, when we're looking at these, depending on what treatment we're on, because sometimes in certain higher doses of these phytochemicals, or herbs or supplements, they may actually interact with treatment. So if you want to do an herb or some kind of supplement, that curcumin, green tea, or something else that you have heard of, you always want to make sure you're running that by your team or your dietitian to make sure that it's actually safe to take during your treatment. Other bioactive compounds and components that are found in foods, this is another, just an example of why we want to make sure we're getting ample color. Resveratrol, genistein, sulforaphane, these are found in whole foods and are helpful in terms of neuroprotection, anti-inflammation. So the more color in your day, the more color in your life, the better. Genistein, I'll hang here for a second, just because this is a phytochemical that is found in soy foods. And I know soy food is a hot topic with breast cancer patients. If anything, we are now finding that this phytoestrogen may actually block estrogen receptors in the body. And if it's blocked, that estrogen receptor is blocked by phytoestrogen, your body's endogenous estrogen is not actually able to bind and turn on that receptor. So these phytoestrogens do not behave like the estrogens that are found endogenously or within the body, but they can actually bind and block to prevent those receptors from being turned on. So we don't discourage people from consuming whole soy foods. What is a whole soy food? Whole soy food is things like unsweetened soy milk or tofu, edamame. Sometimes people will ask me about consuming bars or protein drinks that have soy protein isolate. I'm not as big of a fan of those just because we don't know. We don't have enough evidence to say when you super concentrate the soy protein into supplement forms or bar forms, we don't necessarily know if there is any issue with, particularly with women that have estrogen receptor positive breast cancers. So we say, once again, you'll hear a lot of recurring themes in this presentation, I would recommend that you consume the whole food form of soy, whole food form of snack foods instead of doing processed forms. Okay? Now, interestingly, it's important to note that there's a collaboration between these plant-based foods. So there's been some studies that have looked at extracting these phytochemicals and putting them in capsule form. And when we actually look at research and studies where we compare that encapsulated form of that phytochemical versus eating the whole food, the people that eat the whole food in that form actually have higher concentrations and tend to have more of the anti-inflammatory or anti-disease response than when we isolate it. So the belief is, in a tomato, for example, there are components within the tomato outside of the phytochemical that help the phytochemical work and be active in the body. Also, when we look at certain colorful foods, fruits and vegetables, we know that adding fats to them at mealtimes makes them more bioavailable. We know that with some curcumin, for example, if we use that as a spice for its anti-cancer properties in our cooking, we know to pair it with pepper to make it more bioavailable. So by having more of a balanced diet, which we'll see here, by having the whole grains play with the phytochemicals from the fruit or from the veg, play with the protein and the healthful fats, this balance, we believe, is something we can't, I don't know, take out in, you know, tubes and refine down and put into capsules or into bars and have the same effect. So we really are aiming for this balanced intake. If we go back to the portion sizes, now we can kind of visualize this perhaps a little bit better. So if you imagine a fist worth of whole grain at your meals, two fists worth of those high fiber, high water containing vegetables at lunch and dinner. Because fruit has a little bit more concentrated carbohydrate, we still want to stick to about a fist of that when we have that at a meal or a snack. Protein-rich foods, you can see about a fourth of the plate or a third of the plate at breakfast. And so these can go anywhere. You can have your proteins that are at breakfast go to lunch and dinner. You can have lunch and dinner proteins show up at breakfast. This doesn't have to be kind of segregated by mealtime. The idea is you see a lot of color at these meals. You see lean protein, which is helpful for building and repairing as you go through treatment. Remember, one of the first things we started talking about was physical activity. So if you are doing strength-based exercise, if you are doing cardiovascular exercise, we do want to be able to repair your tissue, and we do that by the building blocks we get from protein-rich foods. So lean protein-rich foods at mealtimes or snacks. The whole grains, I want to spend a little bit of time talking about those because I think poor carbohydrates get a bad rap. The reason why carbohydrates get a bad rap is we typically tend to overconsume them, and we tend to eat the more processed, refined version of that particular type of food. So if we eat the right portion side of the food and we eat the whole grain, so if we're doing whole grain or we're doing brown rice or wild rice, if we're doing Ezekiel breads or high-fiber whole grain breads, cereals that are very low in sugar and high in fiber, these have a lot of nutrition. They're also going to help us feel full and satisfied and help keep our blood sugar steady. So I don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater when we talk about carbohydrates. They're important, they're helpful, and they're not the devil. It's just how we eat them and how we eat the other stuff on the plate that makes a difference. Healthy fats, they actually don't have their own place on the plate because they are very high in calories and small portions. Does that mean we don't eat them? Absolutely not. What it means is we just have to watch our portion size of them. So to add nuts on top of a salad or an oatmeal, to have a couple tablespoons of hummus on a sandwich or as a snack, to drizzle olive oil in a salad or to use that to cook, to have a third or a half of an avocado on a sandwich, okay? So it's not a ton of fat, but we do want to make sure it's showing up because of its anti-inflammatory properties, because of its filling properties, okay? So this balance is also very important, and the quality of your food is very important because of this reason. Stabilizing our blood sugar as we go through treatment, or even for survivorship, or to prevent other disease, is incredibly important. This is where we get into a little bit of a sticking point when people are afraid of sugar. Sugar is not necessarily the issue in and of itself. It's the amount, of sugar that we consume at one time, and it's how frequently we do that. If you look at the first line on this chart, the red line, number one, this is a result of overconsuming carbohydrate. What happens when you overconsume carb is your blood sugar is going to spike. Well, if we're healthy, if we have a healthy pancreas, the pancreas is going to respond to that by releasing insulin. Insulin and our pancreas, if it's a healthy pancreas, it says, I got you. I'm going to take care of you. I'm actually going to release a ton of insulin to make sure that blood sugar comes down. In doing so, in releasing too much insulin, our blood sugar ends up going too low. So now you see that first red line go below the happy, wavy blue line of stable blood sugar. Our blood sugar is actually dropping too low. And when our blood sugar drops too low, I'm assuming a lot of us have recalled the feeling of low blood sugar, we're usually not that pleasant to be around. We tend to have cravings for more what? Carbohydrate. Our body, because it's protecting us and looking out for us, wants to get the blood sugar back up. And the things that do that very quickly are refined processed foods. So you might find yourself, some people, if you have a really carb too heavy breakfast or refined carbs, if you have a really sugary coffee drink or you have a lot of bagels with, you know, jelly or something like that without the protein, without the whole grain, without some healthy fat, that can create a spike in your blood sugar. And then at some point, usually mid-morning or before lunch, you crash. And so that's when everybody's running for their coffee drink. But unfortunately, the coffee drink might have a lot of sugar in it. And then they have that pastry that looks particularly irresistible because their blood sugar is low. And then we spike again. And so this can create what we refer to as the blood sugar roller coaster, where our blood sugar is just going up and down all day long. This I would refer to as an inflammatory state. This is what we want to avoid. Does that mean if you have an occasional spike every few days, that's problematic? I would say that's far less problematic. So in other words, if you say, wow, I'm really wanting that bagel and I want a little orange juice with it, okay, that might create a little bit of spike in your blood sugar. But if that's a very rare occasion, I'm not concerned about it. If it's happening every morning or if it happens multiple times a day, that concerns me because that can lead to potential growth of cancer cells, occurrence of other disease, diabetes for sure when we're on this roller coaster, heart disease. So how do we stay on the happy blue line? The happy blue line is based on the previous slide where you had that beautiful combination of whole grains, lots of fibrous foods, lean protein, and healthful fats. So foods that steady you see on this slide, things like avocado, eggs, nuts and seeds, lean proteins. Also, really, the high-fibery vegetable foods as well because they're low in carbohydrate. So that's the line we want to stay on. Again, because we want to be realistic and because we're all human beings, there are going to be times when our blood sugar spikes because we have a piece of birthday cake and, you know, something higher in carbohydrate or more sweet. I'm not concerned about that happening when it happens very occasionally. It's just that if you find in your diet right now you're eating a lot of processed foods, see where you can start replacing them with, again, the identifiable foods, the whole foods, the foods that are high in fiber, lean protein, whole grains, because that's going to prevent those spikes from happening as often. Always moving towards more food, more of a diet that we can identify. It makes a big difference. Okay, so managing side effects of treatment. I'm only going to include a couple slides here on this because I think typically when I work with patients with breast cancer, there are some recurring themes. Some people will obviously have nausea, vomiting, some changes in bowel movements. And for those populations, there are some very specific things that we can do to manage those side effects. And so certainly talk with your team, certainly talk with a dietitian on how to do that. But today, because we don't have too much time, I wanted to actually look at some of the side effects that I feel are often not talked about with breast cancer patients, and so I really want to hone in on those. Sometimes we'll have patients that are on certain treatments or stress is elevated, and you see more cravings and increased hunger. So, for example, patients on steroids will say, man, my appetite is through the roof. I'm finding myself craving a lot of food, and I can't satisfy myself. So some of our recommendations we just covered. if your meals are imbalanced, if you're eating meals that are really high in carbohydrate, don't have any protein, and no fiber, you are more likely to find yourself in a position to crave those. You created that spike and then that drop in blood sugar. So make sure you're balancing your meals, because that will set you up to have more of a gradual rise and a gradual fall in your blood sugar. Fiber, fiber, fiber. So if we think about, imagine a plate full of whatever vegetable that you're willing to eat. So I would say Brussels sprouts. I don't know if people eat Brussels sprouts, but now they're kind of all the craze. So like, imagine some roasted Brussels sprouts. There are only so many of those you can eat before you feel like you're going to explode. They're incredibly filling. So if you're finding yourself in a position where you are having difficulty satiating yourself from a steroid perspective or from a need to kind of soothe yourself, and until we find other strategies to soothe ourselves, because ideally we're not doing it with food, but if you're finding you need to nosh on something, you can only consume so much fiber before you are going to be full. So fiber works. Find the fiber that you find enticing and satisfying and choose that. Identify and differentiate between true hunger and stress or boredom eating. This is really big, and this also requires compassion for yourself. A lot of us have been stress and boredom eating for a very, very long time. So if this behavior is going to change, it's going to change likely very slowly as you build more awareness in distinguishing between stress eating, boredom eating, and true hunger. So I talk about compassionate curiosity. You have to look at how you have a relationship with food from a very curious, which has a light feather touch to it, and compassionate way. For some people, this is the first time they're thinking about, oh my gosh, maybe I think I kind of stress eat, or I think I soothe myself. What are some ways I can do that without food? You have to be kind, and you have to think about collecting data. Collecting data isn't a heavy-handed process. It's a curious process. So be kind as you start fleshing out the difference between, am I actually hungry here, or am I having a response to a stressful situation? Be an advocate. I'm actually going to talk more about this towards the end when we're looking at family and societal and cultural relationships with food and how we feed our loved ones that are going through treatment. But you need to be an advocate for what comes into your home, for what foods you have in your cabinet, if people are bringing in foods or the foods that someone grocery shops for you. You need to be your own mama bear. You need to create boundaries and say yes and no to what comes into your home. Okay, and then here at the Zakem Center at Dana-Farber, we have integrative therapy. So if you're not somebody that has access to Dana-Farber, look and see within the community or other within your own institution if you have a place that provides integrative therapies, things like meditation. We are very lucky to have a very comprehensive set of programs and groups for people here, whether it's Reiki, acupuncture, music therapy, Qigong or Tai Chi meditation. Tap into these, because if you do find yourself struggling to manage your own stress, there's many different ways that you can help address that instead of using food for calming and comforting. Okay, so remember, if we're looking at nutrition from an integrative perspective, we're also certainly influenced by our society, food systems, politics, our healthcare system. So let's just take a quick peek at that, just to bring awareness to how you could be influenced by this quadrant of the integral perspective. So very infrequently, I'm guessing, or never have you seen a commercial advocating vegetables or fruits or your local farmers. But we are exposed on a very regular basis to advertising from big food corporations. They have a lot of money, and they've also figured out what kind of food lights up your brain. So just like some drugs, certain types of food combinations will release dopamine in your brain. And food companies know this, and they'll design foods to make sure your brain is lit up. Because if your brain's lit up and it feels good, you're going to come back for more. So knowing that certain foods are designed to trigger you might, again, cultivate more compassion, because you realize that we're not all necessarily on the same team. some people in society are out to make money and figure out how they can make some bucks off of you, not necessarily worried about your health and wellness. So you might, again, have to be your own mama bear and say, you know what, I know this certain food or I know these foods. Man, once I start, I can't stop. And I'm guessing a lot of us have that. Some fortunate people don't have that. I definitely have it. It's called Oreos. So I know I don't keep a bag of those in the house because once I start with those, it tends to be a slippery slope. This is an excellent book by David Kessler called The End of Overeating, Taking Control of the Insatiable American Appetite. He talks about the food industry actually bringing in people. There are companies, organizations, and consultants that will come in to actually help make these hyper-palatable, the phrase hyper-palatable food. They figure out the exact level of sugar, fat, and salt to make foods. I want to be careful with the word addictive because I know that's kind of controversial that foods can be addictive. But to make foods hyper-palatable, make you want to come back for more. They figure out the right texture dynamics, flavor dynamics. These are terms that food companies use to figure out the perfectly constructed potato chip. Or you might have heard the Dorito being the perfectly engineered food product. It works in every way. Smell, taste, swallow, the whole thing. It works because they perfectly engineered that food product. Okay, so those were all things that we can actually measure. Science has helped us out. We've got a lot of data on that stuff. But what we don't have a lot of data on, but what I would argue is as important, sometimes more important, is what is going on internally, whether it's within the individual going through this cancer journey or whether it's within a culture, within a family, within a friend support system. So let's take a few minutes to assess and consider some of the things we can't measure and how they're important. So we're going to take just a minute, wherever you are. See if you can find yourself comfortably in your seat with your feet on the floor, your back up against the back of the chair, your hands in your lap, or on the arms of the chair. And I want you to close your eyes if that's comfortable for you. And I want you to go way back in time. Take a couple deep breaths. And I want you to imagine one of your most favorite foods when you were a little girl or little boy. Imagine one of your most favorite foods. What did it look like? Did it have a smell? Imagine how that food, whether it was a sweet or a dessert, how did it taste? What were the textures? Who was with you? Who was surrounding you when you ate this favorite food? Was this a happy time? Was this perhaps a birthday party or an enjoyable event, or was it just a Saturday afternoon? How did you feel? Did you feel lucky? Did you feel loved? We'll slowly come back to my voice, the presentation, and hopefully in those 60 seconds, you were able to have a moment back in time when you had a food that you had a relationship with. And there might have been even some, I'm guessing, emotions that came up while you were envisioning that food. And that is an important piece because that doesn't change with a cancer diagnosis. Your relationship, your history, your food memories, those all very much influence how you go into this journey as well. So again, David Kessler has a section, and he talks about there's an emotional experience that goes along with eating for a lot of us, and we can't underestimate that. So thinking about our support systems, how are families and friends supportive during treatment? So I have these pictures up because these are the most frequently heard of food items that people bring loved ones when they're going through treatment. And not surprisingly, these are the food items I hear people most often complaining of getting too much of over the course of their treatment. So I'm I'm wondering, and I would ask you to consider how you could advocate for yourself. We talked about this a little bit more, and we're coming back around to it. How could you advocate for yourself to make your journey better in terms of your food, in terms of your nutrition? So we finally here at Dana-Farber created this handout that we're going to start providing to patients who are saying they're struggling with this very thing. They don't want to be rude. They don't want to offend people who are being very gracious in helping out and making food. Of course you don't. Of course you don't want to tell the people that are being so kind and making food that actually could you please have something that isn't a lasagna. So we decided to come up with this handout to help people to simply provide this to our families, to people, to church groups or whatever if they're asking to provide you with some meals or your family with some food as you're going through treatment. So this is an example, an easy way for you to just circle some things. And if you don't have access to this particular handout, think about creating something on your own. Think about creating a list. I want to highlight this bottom paragraph here on this handout that says, and you can think of maybe wording this in your own way if you want to create a little something. Your loved one is currently working with a nutritionist who specializes in cancer care. In our experience, patients often become stressed when exposed to many different sources of information related to nutrition and cancer, often gleaned from books and the internet. Although you may have the best intentions, and people almost always do, please be aware of the potential risks of sharing nutrition information, which may or may not be based on sound evidence and may be overwhelming and create confusion. We are always available to our patients to answer questions as needed. So this is just another example of being your own mama bear, protecting yourself, and letting people know that you're getting support from a dietitian or your cancer team. And if they have any thoughts or recommendations in terms of diets you should be eating, foods you should be avoiding, that you will hear that, you're happy to hear that, and you will bounce it off of your care team or your dietitian. So this is the last page of the handout. This might be something that you want to ask for instead of meals. You might know what foods are working for you. You might want certain fruits and vegetables. It's a great idea to tell people to bring groceries instead of cooked meals. So say, you know, peanut butter is working great for me right now. So are apples, and so are frozen veg, which are easy and quick for me to prepare. Also at the bottom, you see some resources. So they can have a few cookbook ideas or things like that to reference from in making some healthy food choices. Okay, so when we talk about protecting yourself, when we talk about the internal experience of going through this journey, one of the things I oftentimes will tell people in the groups that I lead is in terms of self-care, if you find you're in a position where the S is hitting the fan, the last thing you want to do is actually stand right in front of it, okay? So when things are going crazy and you have a lot going on, it's best to lay low and go slow. So figure out the things you do have control over. You might not be able to start a new exercise regimen, going 3 times a week, doing CrossFit 2x a week, pumping iron, doing cardio. You might not be able to start balancing every meal and eating tons of veg and fruit and nothing processed. That is too much. You have to lay low and go slow. Figure out which things you do have some control over. Figure out which things are manageable and doable right now. And those are the things that you should bite off, small bites, and start chewing on. The rest of it, know that at some time, when things calm down a little bit more, you can take on a little bit more of the healthy living lifestyle and choose a few more of these to implement. But lay low and go slow when a lot of stuff is going on. Be kind to yourself. Remember that compassionate curiosity. And just do a few things to keep moving forward. You don't have to stand still. When you're diagnosed, you can keep moving forward, but be reasonable with how much you take on. I have a few resources here, happy for you to look at. Our Ask the Nutritionist app is getting a little bit of an upgrade, so if you don't have access to it right now, it is a free app that at some point will be up and running and smooth and having lots of new recipes and good stuff. Okay, and so now we will switch over to taking some questions. But before we do that, thank you. Thanks for joining. whether live or online. I really appreciate it, and hopefully this was helpful. So we can transition now, I think, to taking some questions. All right. Okay, so the first question, where can patients whose cuisines are international different from atypical or from typical American fare find relevant dietary guidance? Great question. I would say that I don't actually know of too many places that have standardized recommendations for different cultural cuisine. So my recommendation for you would actually be, and I do this with a lot of my clients, is actually draw the plates that you saw here on this presentation, and then you know that there's places for whole grains, you know there's places for fruits, you know there's places for veg and lean protein. If you're not sure what goes in those different components from your own cultural cuisine, I would actually meet with a dietitian that can help and look up your different typical foods and typical cultural cuisine to help you fill in those parts of the plate. But that's a good place to start if you're not sure of the general recommendations in terms of your cuisine, is actually start by filling out a blank plate by yourself, and where you need a little bit more help, I would consult with a dietitian. Would a patient following a restricted diet, vegan for example, be at any nutritional disadvantage during treatment? Good question. So vegans, the one thing that we consider with veganism, because vegans, for people that don't know, they don't eat any animal products at all, so no dairy, eggs, any of the meat products. One thing that we are a little bit concerned about is your B12 status. That could be something, because that's only found in animal products, that could be low. So not necessarily anything different than we would advocate from the general population other than the B12, and then also making sure that you're getting adequate protein from plant-based foods, and you can certainly do that. So from your beans, lentils, nuts and seeds, hummus, tofu, soy products, by varying those you should be able to get enough protein. So make sure you're varying your protein and you're getting enough, and consider a B12 supplement if you have that tested by your physician and it's low. What are some more examples of good high-fiber foods? Okay, high-fiber foods, remember those phytochemically rich vegetables and fruits. Other high-fiber whole grain type foods would be quinoa. A lot of people are familiar with quinoa, rice. Sweet potatoes are very high in fiber. Oddly enough, avocados are also very high in fiber, even though they're a healthful fat food. Your nuts and seeds also have quite a bit of fiber, so throwing some of those in to accent your meals will help. When people are constipated, we talk about doing things like that, lots of roughage. Some nuts and seeds are helpful in getting things moving along. Is there a difference in the nutritional value of fresh, frozen, and canned vegetables and fruits? Indeed there is. Now the cool thing is that frozen are just as nutrient dense as fresh, which means that if you're feeling particularly fatigued or tired or you don't have a lot of time, keeping on hand a ton of frozen vegetables is a quick, easy way to make sure half of your plate is colorful at your mealtimes. Canned, I'm not a huge fan of canned, and the reason for that is because in the canning process, sometimes you lose nutrition, and typically there tends to be added sodium. So your content goes up and you actually lose a little bit of nutrition in the canning process. What are my thoughts on organic versus non-organic fruits and vegetables? I've read things about pesticide residue and so forth that are not good. Thank you for this excellent presentation. Well, you're welcome very much. Okay, so thoughts on organic versus non-organic. If you're somebody that is on a budget, but you say the organic is something you want to consider switching over to, you can look at the EWG.org. That's the Environmental Working Group. So EWG.org. They put up a list called the Dirty Dozen and the Clean 15 periodically, and they update it. The Dirty Dozen is the most highly pesticide fruits and vegetables that are out there. So if you want to put your money on anything in terms of organic, I might consider purchasing those foods that are considered Dirty Dozen. For example, apples are usually up there pretty high. Berries are up there pretty high. So if you eat those frequently and you want to reduce your pesticide exposure, it might not be a bad idea to do those types of foods organically more often. Things like bananas, fruits and vegetables that have thick skins, those will have less exposure, the actual meat will have less exposure, and they tend to also have less pesticide residue on them to begin with. So at the end of the day, if you're fearful of pesticides and are wanting to know which is more important than I get, you know, a non-organic and conventionally grown produce, or don't eat it at all because I can't afford organic, we want you to have color in your diet. We want you to have the phytochemicals. It's more important to me that you get those in than you eat all organic. What type of nutrition consults are available at Dana-Farber? We offer all different types. So for any disease, for any type of cancer diagnosis, there's a dietitian for you. We all are experts with all different types of cancer. I am also an integrative dietitian within the Zakim Center. So I see people for more holistic, more integrative nutrition consults down there in the Zakim Center. I focus a lot on sleep quality, stress levels. I look at where you might benefit from other practices like acupuncture, massage therapy. So that's the difference between when I'm in the Zakim Center versus when I'm up on the floors. But those dietitians are very competent and capable too. It's just that we might spend a little bit more time looking at other things in your life and your lifestyle that may be impacting your nutrition. What would I recommend to restore the microbiome after large spectrum antibiotics? Typically, if somebody has, for whatever reason, been on antibiotics for a period of time, it's not a bad idea to do a course of probiotics. So a high-dose probiotic is indicated, particularly if someone has swung into some difficulty with diarrhea or bowel changes, then a high-dose probiotic would be something to consider. And there is some on the market right now. There's Ultimate Flora that you can get, I think, Whole Foods and other grocery stores, and maybe even Amazon has Ultimate Flora. I'm not sponsored by any recommendations I give. I don't have any affiliations with these, but this is one brand that we use with our patients here. There's also something called VSL3, which is a very potent probiotic that sometimes when people really are struggling with bowel movements, your physicians might prescribe that. Ultimately, you still want to check in with a dietitian or a physician before you throw a probiotic into your regimen. So with anything, whether we're talking about herbs, supplements, vitamins, minerals, you always want to check in with your team before you start them, because supplement industry is not regulated. We need to be careful and make sure you're not putting something in your body that could actually do more harm than good. Any questions here? Okay. We were super efficient, super sweet, speedy with this presentation. So I think I answered all of the questions. I'm, again, very grateful. Thank you for the opportunity to hang out with you guys this afternoon, and I'm hoping this was beneficial, and perhaps our paths will cross again in the future. Thank you.